Jesus said, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted." Very warm welcome to St. Mark's and to this very particular and special service of thanksgiving for the life of Stanley Bisby. And a very warm welcome on behalf of me. My name's Dan, I'm the Associate Vicar here, and it's a pleasure to be leading this service. Stan was greatly loved by many people, as a testament to all of you that are here today. I'm sorry for those that are not able to be here because of the limited numbers, but he was also greatly loved, and so was Lorraine, clearly, by our church family here. So I know that there are many people at home who are tuning in to watch this service and to share in this time of Thanksgiving. And so you're very welcome, those of you that are at home. We have come here today to remember before God our brother Stan, to give thanks for his life, to commend him to God, our merciful Redeemer and Judge, and then to commit his body to be cremated. And so we gather here, the friends and family of Stan, to comfort one another in our grief, as we share stories, as we remember who he was, how much he was treasured, and how much he loved so many of us here. And so we come to comfort one another in our time and in our pain. So let us begin with a prayer at the beginning of this service. God of all consolation, your son Jesus Christ was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend. Look with compassion on your children in their loss. Give to troubled hearts the light of hope, and strengthen in us the gift of faith. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you like to be seated? So at the beginning, I'm going to invite Olivia to come up, and she's going to light the Easter candle for us. Stand on here. You stand on there. That's it. Fantastic. Okay. Thanks, Olivia. The candle and the light reminds us of God's presence here with us, and that Jesus claimed to be the light of the world, that he is here with us as we gather to remember and to grieve together. We're going to sit now, and James is going to play our first hymn, Blessed Assurance. Now, unfortunately, we're not able to sing in church, but I would ask you to perhaps follow the words that are printed in your order of service as James plays this wonderful hymn to us. Fantastic. Thank you so much, James, for playing that first hymn. I'm going to invite Lisa to come up, and she's going to share a tribute to her dad.
I don't know whether to say morning or to say afternoon. Do I need to put that down a little bit? Can you hear me? Is that right?
Yeah.
I would like to start by saying thank you to everyone for being here today. I know it's very difficult in the current circumstances, but my mum and I are both very grateful to you all for choosing to be here to celebrate my dad's life in the best way that we can. I have no doubt at all that if it were not for the current restrictions, this church would be full of people, all with their own reasons, give thanks for my dad. Not everyone is lucky enough, even in normal times, to have the confidence that a church would be full to wish their loved one a fond farewell. But I have no hesitation in saying that, because I know that my dad was such a special person, and the cards and letters that my mum and I have received over the past few weeks are a testament to his life. We've been overwhelmed by the kind words that have been expressed about my dad and how he touched so many people's lives. As most people will know, my dad was poorly for quite some time before he passed away on the day before his 81st birthday earlier this month. It's been a very difficult time for all of our family, but I want to take this opportunity to say thank you to my mum, who did an amazing job of taking care of him in the last year of his life. I know that at times it has been overwhelming for her, but she has always been so supportive, and I know that my dad was always so happy to have her by his side. The time that we've had during my dad's illness has allowed me to reflect not just upon the relationship that I had with him, but also on the relationship that he had with others, not just in our family, but his friends and those upon whose lives he touched in the wider community, and to think about why people warmed to him so easily. If I was describing my dad, I would of course describe him as extraordinary, but I think it was actually his ability to just be ordinary that made people love him so much. My dad taught me to always be myself, and that is most certainly how he lived his life. Always respectful, but always himself. And I believe that his ability to do that, along with his fun-loving personality, made him the special person we will all remember. If I were to think of one word that best summed up my dad, it would probably be games. Throughout all of his life, and in so many guises, he loved any opportunity to play a game. In fact, even on Christmas Day, just last month, he didn't really understand the season or the gifts that he was receiving, but he still instigated a game of pass the parcel with his Christmas present. We all played along and laughed, and that will be a lasting memory for me. I'm sure that many of you here will have played a game or two with him over the years. I'm not sure how much games were involved in his early childhood. Born in Retford on the 8th of January 1940 to Harry and Amelia, my dad was one of eight siblings, including his twin sister Jean, who sadly passed away at a very early age. It's lovely to have the Bisby family here with us today. We don't see each other too often, but I know how much he cared for them and always made sure that he kept in touch with the families of his brothers and sisters. My dad moved to the Hunslet area of Leeds when he was very young, and Hunslet was without a doubt the place that he called home, much to Sean's dismay when he's tried to persuade him on many occasions that Harrogate's the best place to live. My dad would always talk so fondly of Hunslet, and I am marvelled to think that throughout all of their childhood and into early adulthood, my parents never really lived more than a mile apart. It must have been fate that took my dad and his family to live in Hunslet that year. My parents both attended Hunslet National School, which was then separated into boys and girls. My dad left school and joined Clayton's Engineering, which would be his workplace for 40 years. Outside of work, he devoted his life to Hunslet Boys Club and the Boys Brigade, where he taught gymnastics and football. I was contacted only a few weeks ago by someone on social media who told me how fondly he remembered my dad, who had taught him gymnastics and football, and how he remembered going on the Boys Brigade camps. I only have a very vague recollection of the club camps, but I do remember the happy spirit of being at the camp, and I know how much good work they did in the local community. In the 1960s, the so-called slums of Hunslet were pulled down and my dad and his family relocated to Aberfield Drive. As part of that same demolition process, my mum and her mother also moved from Varley Square to Aberfield Drive with Auntie Mary, Uncle Joe and Tony just around the corner. From there, a 53-year love story began. It's my understanding that it didn't go entirely smoothly from the offset. My dad would intentionally wash his van outside the house every Sunday morning when he knew my mum would be leaving to walk to church, and it took several attempts before he persuaded her to go on a date with him. But eventually, and with a very shiny van in tow, my parents started courting. And eventually they got engaged in the romantic setting of the number 46 bus stop. They were to wed the following May, but again, fate stepped in because my dad had been offered a place to study to train as a gymnast in Liverpool, but unfortunately my mum's mum passed away and my dad wouldn't leave her alone in Leeds. But not surprisingly, so valued was he at Clayton's that his job was reinstated immediately. And so my parents were married on the 23rd of May 1970, and they spent two glorious weeks on the Yorkshire Riviera, also otherwise known as Scarborough. My dad loves Scarborough, and I have so many memories of holidays there with him, my mum, my dad, my Auntie Mary and Uncle Joe, Tony Joyce and Jessica, and later with Jill and Dave, Tom and Joe, and Phil and Ellie, who I know are watching today. Good family times at the chalet, which we will continue to enjoy. A special place where my dad will always be with us. I will always remember him paddling in the sea in all weathers and playing non-stop cricket in the shelter with the leaky roof when it rained. All the kids would follow him to play a game. He was so popular wherever he went. Spending time with my dad was always great fun. He called me Lisa B from over the sea, and I can honestly never remember an occasion when I asked him to play a game and he said no. Not surprisingly, my dad's favourite game was camping, which involved getting out lots of old sheets, moving the furniture around and making tents. It went on for hours while my dolls had tent inspections. I'm sure you enjoyed that, Mum. My dad was always involved with youth work all of his life, initially with the Boys Club in the Brigade and later with the Pathfinders when my parents joined West Grange Church. I remember being jealous when I had to share him for an hour with the other children every Thursday night. His love of working with children would eventually cross into his working life when, after being made redundant after 40 years at Clayton's, he managed to find a position at Leeds Girls High School, where he worked until retirement. We will treasure his Arj Quo Argis shield, which was given to him on retirement. Arj Quo Argis means the resilient worker, and that's a fitting tribute to my dad. The girls and staff at the school thought so much of him, and of course he also made many good friends, including his friend George, who is listening today and whom he respected and admired so much. My dad was truly the best dad I could ever have hoped for. He even took the decision to leave Leeds and move to Harrogate to be near me and my family when he became a granddad. He was such a fun-loving granddad. His loving spirit was ignited all over again when my children were born. Watching him play with them was just the best. Nothing was ever too much trouble. I know my girls will have the most amazing memories of their granddad, even if they are not the longest ones for Emily. Not only was my dad a truly amazing granddad, he was also a fantastic husband to my mum in the 50 years that they were married, and he welcomed Sean into our family when we were married in 2005. It's fair to say that Sean was quite shocked the first time he came to Auntie Mary's Boxing Day party, and my dad put on his VHS quiz of the year. But he stuck with it, and as Boxing Day has become our family party over the years, he has persuaded us all that games were the best way to spend your time. My dad's life wasn't always about fun and games. In particular, his faith was very important to him and something he took very seriously, although he did get the congregation of the Thursday group here at St. Mark's to join him in a game of table tennis or two. My parents have both benefited greatly from the community spirit at St. Mark's, and I would like to thank all of the community here for the care and support they've shown to my parents over the last 10 months. The hole that my dad leaves in our hearts is incredibly deep. even deeper than his sandcastles, and I have no idea how we will fill it. But my dad always taught me three little words, and I know that Jill and Dave will be thinking about those before I even say them. That is to never give in. And for you, Dad, I promise I'll never give in, and I'll follow the example you've taught me every day.
Thank you, Lisa, for that wonderful tribute to Stan's life. He was a much-loved member here at our congregation on a Thursday and on a Sunday morning. And you're indeed right, table tennis figured quite largely. And getting the older members of our congregation to play table tennis was no mean feat, it has to be said. I'm sure that all of you have got your own memories and thoughts, your stories, the treasured times you spent with Stan. He was a man with a big heart who loved people, loved being with people and talking with people. He was always wanting to find out how you were, and was always way more interested in what you were up to and what was going on in your life than he was in wanting to share what he'd been up to. And I'm sure that you've all got a particular story or way that you want to remember him. So as we listen to James playing our next hymn, which is going to be, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder stand, I encourage you to just be thinking about the image or the picture or the way in which you're going to remember Stan. We're here to give thanks for a life well lived, and part of that is remembering the good times and in celebrating and in giving thanks for all that he has meant to so many people here. So I encourage you, bring to mind those times and occasions that you want to thank God for Stan's life, and remember him in a particular way, an image, a story, and treasure that. And let's just listen to this next hymn. You may want to follow the words in the service sheet. Thank you, James.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you, James. I'm just going to prepare the microphone for Olivia to come up. Do you want to come stand here? And Olivia's written a poem for her granddad that she's now going to read to us.
From the first time I was born, I guess you would know, 10 perfect fingers, 10 little toes. When you first put your finger in my tiny hand, that's when I knew that you were my granddad, and no one else would do. As I grew older and reached for the sky, my granddad will still be there to keep that twinkle in my eye. When I need someone to hold me, you would never say, you're too big. You would pick me up and squeeze me like a little kid. Most other people don't understand me, or maybe not as well. That's why you're the one I turn to when I have something to tell. My granddad is so special, that's something everyone can see. I loved Friday, it's still my favorite day of the week. I remember our order at the swimming baths, a hot chocolate, a brownie, and 2 Yorkshire teas. I love you, granddad, as you can see, and that's why you'll always be a part of me.
Thank you, Olivia. I'm going to ask Tony if he will come up and read to us our Bible reading.
The reading is taken from the Gospel of St. John, chapter 14, verses 1 to 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is the gospel of Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Tony, for reading to us that passage from John's Gospel. And thank you, Olivia, for writing that wonderful poem and being able to read that in front of everyone today. That's really a real tribute to your dad, to your granddad, and a real expression of your love for him. So thank you for sharing that with us. Well, as we come to reflect on that Bible passage and just stopping for a moment or two to think about Stan's life, and I guess the thing that kind of comes up front and center is that death always comes as a shock. It doesn't matter how long it's been expected, or how well you think you might have prepared for it, or how many times you might even have rehearsed in your mind what that moment might be like, or how you've steadied yourself for its coming. But it always comes too soon. It always seems to come at the wrong time. But death is a fact. It draws us up. It draws us all up short. We're aware of the separation that it's caused, the pain and the grief that we're left with. It causes a sense of emptiness, an ache in our heart. There's an empty spot, a break in the family circle. And so we rightly grieve. We cry. We mourn. We feel the pain that death brings. And part of what we do in a funeral service is share in that with one another as we bring to mind and we talk about the life of Stan and how much he was loved and how much he meant to each of us. We're acutely aware of the pain that we are each feeling. And in a funeral, we share that pain with one another and support and comfort one another in that time of sadness and grief. But today is also a time for giving thanks for a life that has been well lived. And so we're remembering with thanksgiving as well as grieving today. But let us remember that death is not the end. It says in the Bible, "This is indeed the will of my Father, that all who have seen the Son and believe in him will have eternal life." And Stan firmly believed in life after death, that he would be with God the Father for eternity. He was totally at peace because he knew where he was going. He had complete confidence and assurance that he would be with the Father for eternity. He was going to be with the one who created him, loved him, called him by name, and saved him. He is now seeing his Lord face to face. It was with that certain knowledge that he would be with the Lord that led to that deep sense of peace. And in our reading that Tony just read to us, we heard the voice of Jesus as he spoke to his disciples in their confusion and in their need. As they heard Jesus speak of his own coming and imminent death, Jesus spoke these words to the disciples. He says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." Now that might seem rather strange, slightly odd, but it's quite natural to be troubled by the death of a friend or a loved one. We feel loss personally. We see loss in the eyes of each other. We sense the impact. And so for the disciples who heard those words for the first time from Jesus' lips, their fear was in losing the one that they were coming to know as their friend, their master, their Lord, the Christ, the one who was sent from God, the one who was God. And their emotions are raw. There's a sense of disbelief and not being able to comprehend what he was saying. But at the same time, Jesus was promising that there is a way for troubled hearts to turn. There is something to fill the empty space that has been left behind. And so Jesus says to the disciples, "Trust in God, trust also in me." We will naturally feel loss and have a sense of restlessness, perhaps in our bellies, as we reflect on the subject of death. But hear the words of Jesus. Trust in God. He challenges us to turn to the living God with our sorrow and with our pain and with our doubts and with our questions and with our fear about death. God is our maker. He gives and he takes away. It makes sense that we would turn ourselves toward God. Perhaps open our hearts to God more than we might otherwise when we start to wrestle with life's big questions. But Jesus also says to trust in him. He says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Jesus is sufficient. More than enough to meet all of these troubles, all of the needs that we have. He is the way to peace. He is our peace. He gives a peace that passes all understanding. Jesus says to us that he fulfills all of these longings, that he's just not a way, a truth, a life, but rather he is the way, the truth, and the life. Life in its fullness is experienced in Jesus. And this is the invitation of the scripture. This is Jesus who conquered death at the cross, who came as the visible, tangible expression of who God is and what he is like. This Jesus who invites us in our sadness and our pain and our grief to turn to him to find comfort, to be embraced by the love of God. This Jesus who promises to walk with us and talk with us and live our life with him, and then to enjoy eternity in the presence of God forever. When Jesus walked this earth, he conquered death by dying on the cross. He offered us a way to meet him and his Father in heaven. The Bible tells us death has been swallowed up in victory, that death has lost its sting. No longer does death hold fear over us. We have the promise of eternal life, a life after death, being in the presence of a loving God forever. I pray that you might know his comfort, each of you today, in the midst of your grief and your pain. Shall we pray together now? Father in heaven, we give you thanks for your servant Stan. We praise you as we recollect his life and cherish his memory. We bless you that in bearing your image, he has brought light to our lives. For we have seen in his friendship reflections of your compassion, in his integrity demonstrations of your goodness, in his faithfulness glimpses of your eternal love. Grant to each of us, beloved and bereft, the grace to follow his good example, so that we with him may come to your everlasting kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who died and rose again and opened the gate of glory, to whom be praise for all eternity. Amen. Lord God, we pray for all those who mourn. Be gentle with them in their grief. Show them the depth of your love and a glimpse of the kingdom of heaven. Be with them as we weep beside the empty tomb of our risen Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to invite you to join in the words of the Lord's Prayer, which you can find printed in your order of service. So we say together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. As we draw towards the close of our service, I'm going to invite you all to please stand as we now commend Stanley to the mercy of God, our Maker and our Redeemer. And so just before this final prayer, we're going to pause for a moment or two and an opportunity for some quiet reflection. You might want to offer your own prayer. You might just want to stand and remember Stanley in a particular way. Almighty God, as you bring us face to face with our mortality, we thank you for making each one of us in your own image and giving us gifts in body, mind, and spirit. And we thank you now as we honour the memory of Stan, whom you have given to us and have taken away. We entrust him to your mercy and pray that you will show us the path of life and the fullness of joy in your presence through all eternity. Amen. Before I conclude with the blessing, can I just say thank you all for joining with us. The family would like to say that they hope to be able to organise a memorial service at some point when it becomes possible in the future, to which we would love to see all the friends and family of Stanley come together to celebrate and to share together. There is a collection and that will be taken up for the work of cancer research if you would like to contribute towards that. In a moment or two, when I've given the final blessing, the coffin is going to be taken out through the front doors and down to the crematorium, and the family will follow out through the front door. Can I ask the rest of you to remain here just for a moment or two and then to exit via the door over here to your right? Thank you for coming today and sharing in this service of thanksgiving for Stanley's life. It's been really good to see you all here and share with you in that today. So may God give you his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and the next. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.